This pan pizza recipe is sponsored by Squarespace, the cast iron pan of website builders. By that I mean it can do anything. Building, hosting, and even running your website or online store. To get 10% off your site, go to squarespace.com/ragusea.
This is a style of pizza associated with the American Midwest. I fell in love with it at a place in Bloomington, Indiana called Mother Bear's. And if I'm honest, this style is much more suited to the home kitchen than, say, Neapolitan or New York style pizzas. Why? Because it's baked at normal home oven temperatures, and if you do it my way, it requires virtually no preheating. This starts with a variation of my basic pizza dough, which I normally make in a machine, but here's how you can do it by hand. If possible, get a wide bowl, and then put in a quarter teaspoon of yeast, a teaspoon of sugar, and half a cup of warm water. Stir it around and let it bloom for 5 minutes, just to make sure that your yeast is still alive. In goes a glug of olive oil, and we'll start with 1 cup of flour and a half teaspoon of salt. Then I just start mixing with a silicone spatula, though you could certainly do this with your hands. Once I've done everything I can do with the spatula, I throw some flour on my hand and get kneading. Some people would move this to a board for this stage, but if you've got a wide bowl, you can do it all in here, and you can keep the entire mess contained in here. I'm just folding and then leaning into it with my palm. Here's the thing that I think I've learned about pizza dough. The wetter it is, the better it tastes. I mean, I'm sure there's an upper limit on that, but I haven't hit it yet. The only downside of a wet, sticky dough is it's hard to work with and it's likely to stick to the peel. But with this recipe, we won't be using a peel, so that's a moot point. I just keep adding just enough flour such that I can keep kneading it. And if it's kind of sticky and messy, who cares? I'm using bread flour, but you could totally use all-purpose. I think this style of pizza is better if it's a little softer, i.e. less chewy. And by that same token, I don't think that you have to knead this to death, just until you can stretch it out thin without it tearing. Toss some olive oil on top and grease her up, and use her to grease the sides of the bowl. This is just enough dough for one pizza, and if it starts off round, it'll be easier to stretch out round later. Cover it up, and I normally like a long, cold rise in the fridge, at least a day and up to a week. But let's just rise it on the table today. After an hour and a half or so, it'll look like that, doubled in size. Yes, I had sworn off cast iron pans. Thing is, my friend David finds and restores antique cast iron pans, and he gave me this beautiful 10-inch one as a present. It was made in Alabama, maybe as early as the 1930s, and how are you gonna say no to that? I've been working on giving it a good cure, and you're gonna need one lest your pizza stick. Enough olive oil to coat the pan goes in, and it's amazing how much non-stick insurance you can buy with just a pinch of cornmeal. That combination of oil and cornmeal is magically non-stick. Now rev up your meme machines, boys and girls, because yes, I'm going to season my pan, not my pizza. Good amount of black pepper, a few shakes of oregano maybe, and a little pinch of salt. Just mix it all up and get everything coated with it, especially those corners and along those edges. Now, while your hands are still greasy, grab your dough ball. Wow, that is soft and sticky. This is one reason I prefer to work with refrigerated dough. It's stiffer. You can just let gravity do the work here. Rotate, let it fall and stretch. Rotate, let it fall and stretch. You want to get it stretched a little wider than your pan. That will ensure a snug fit. Got a hole in there. No prop. I'll just tear off some excess and patch it up. This does not have to look pretty. It's all going to get covered up, edge to edge. Just let that sit and proof. That means rise a second time, right there in the pan for a half hour. I'll explain why later. Now, sauce. I have grown disenchanted with San Marzano tomatoes lately, and boy have I found something better for pizza sauce. Hashtag not an ad, this is the best widely available canned tomato product in the US for raw pizza sauce. Pastene Kitchen Ready Ground Tomatoes. I think a third of a cup is the precise right amount for a 10-inch pizza. Then I do a glug of olive oil, a pinch of sugar, and maybe tear in some fresh basil today, and that is it. If you pre-cook pizza sauce, it tends to make your pizza taste more like lasagna than pizza. And that's a particular hazard with this thick casserole-style pizza we're making today. Find you a canned tomato that tastes good enough raw. And it doesn't need salt. Plenty of salt in the cheese and the crust. Speaking of cheese, the secret for any pizza style with a thick layer of cheese is low-moisture mozzarella, and whole milk mozzarella has the best flavor. That's a combination of traits that is harder to find than a lot of people realize. I was able to find it in my tiny city in the form of sticks, which is fine. These are 1 ounce each. I think you want 4 ounces for this pizza. And throw it into the fridge until you're ready to use it. I'll explain why in a sec. Toppings. I'm not a big toppings guy, but one topping I can get behind is very thinly sliced chilies, pizza diablo. That's just a jalapeño. I think toppings need to be strong enough in flavor such that they can work very thin and or in very small quantities. Otherwise, they throw off the texture and the cooking. Okay, let's cook this thing. You want to be sure to use your largest burner. If the burner is too small, the pan will heat unevenly and the middle of the pizza will burn. Look how puffy our dough has gotten after proofing in there for a half hour. All right, burner goes on medium heat, and I'll go ahead and turn my broiler on high. Brits, that means your grill. This sure is more energy efficient than preheating a pizza stone for an hour. Now is when I go ahead and spoon on my sauce. And here's the part that feels unnatural to me. You spread the sauce edge to edge. This pizza will not have a bare rim. And here's why I think it's important to proof the pizza until puffy in the pan. We're starting to cook the pizza's underside right now. This will partially set the bread structure before it goes into the oven, which will restrict its so-called oven spring. Oven spring is when the water in dough converts to steam in the oven and inflates the bread before it sets up hard. This is going to be partially set before it gets a chance to really steam up, so we're going to lose some oven spring. We've compensated for that by essentially pre-springing our bread, by inflating it with carbon dioxide from our yeast instead of steam from our water. I've put on my grated Parmesan, and now, after the heat's been on for 5 minutes, I'll get my mozz out of the fridge and put that on, again, edge to edge. Keeping your mozz cold up until the last possible second is the secret to making sure it doesn't overheat in the oven and split, squeezing out its fat in an orange grease layer. Toppings go on, and this right here is the only really tricky part of this recipe, judging when to pull this off the heat and put it under the broiler. If you leave it on too long, the bottom will be burned. I think it just takes some practice. With my oven, my pan, 7 or 8 minutes from the time I turn on the heat is the magic time. Rack in a high position, broiler on high, because this is going to happen fast, just until the cheese is brown to your liking. This one took 4 minutes. Out it comes, not onto the hot burner you were just cooking on. I totally haven't made that mistake before. Look how pretty that is, and barely a drop of orange grease. You keep the cheese cold, the surface of it browns before the interior can overheat. There's no rush getting this out of the pan. You want to let it solidify. When the cheese firms up, you can grab a butter knife and just go around the edge to release those crispy bits, aka the best part. I'll grab myself a cooling rack, you could do this straight onto a board, and if you've let it cool down, you should be able to pull it off with some tongs. The bottom might stick a little, but it should break off. Look at what those edge-to-edge toppings get you. That's the Mother Bears effect I loved in Indiana. Super caramelized cheese, sauce, and bread around the edge. Here's an angle of my kitchen I don't show you very often. Check out the bottom. Beautiful golden brown. If you don't cook the pan on the stove, if you just put the pan cold into the oven, as some pan pizza recipes have you do, you won't get this. The bottom will be pale and bready, and the overall product will be more like focaccia than a pizza. Surely I am not the first person to do this seasoning the pan business, right? It's amazing. It makes the crust taste like a breadstick. Now, you might be wondering, do I need a cast iron skillet? Can I do this with a Teflon pan? Yes, you can. I did it. Went great. Only problem is I undercooked the bottom. I think because my nonstick pan is less massive, it holds on to less heat. I needed to give it more time on the stovetop. Might take some practice, but yeah, that is possible. Now you might be wondering, isn't it dangerous to put Teflon under the broiler? Maybe, but I don't think so in this case. I hope to answer all of your nonstick health and safety questions on Monday.
However, I can answer all of your website questions right now. Squarespace. How do all these people have a beautiful website that would cost thousands to get custom designed and built? Squarespace. How do people have a fully functional online store on their website when they definitely don't have a team of developers designing and running that for them? Squarespace. How did my friend, who isn't tech savvy in the slightest, figure out how to register a custom domain? Squarespace. How does this food blogger seamlessly integrate beautiful photos and video and text? Squarespace. How can I sear, fry, roast, braise, and even cook an omelet in the same pan? Well-cured cast iron, which is basically like Squarespace. Squarespace is all I need, and it's probably all you need too. To get 10% off your first website or domain registration, go to squarespace.com/ragusea and enter my offer code RAGUSEA. That's all right down in the description. Thanks to Squarespace for sponsoring this video. Thanks also to some folks whose consultations helped me develop this pizza recipe. My neighbor, Rebecca Richard, also Vinegar Leggett's Dan Linux and Matt Zielinski. Yes, I have decided to start calling my regular viewers Vinegar Leggets. T-shirts coming soon.